Clayton, and I teach first grade at St. Mary's School, and I'm also the parish DRE as well. So I'm delighted to be here today to talk to you about what I know about engaging families in a catechetical setting. First, we're going to start with a prayer service on the purple sheet. I have a little video.
To go solar, you used to have to install solar panels on your roof. Not anymore. Today, utility customer.
That doesn't sound like that song.
Sorry. Well, it was an interesting song there.
You will be my voice.
The season of Lent stretches before us with unlimited possibilities to grow closer to our Father and experience His love and mercy. There is no sin too great to be beyond the unlimited forgiveness of God. We must bring forth our own faults with sincere sorrow, and we can have confidence He will respond to us as a caring, loving shepherd and welcome us back.
When we pray and talk with God, we build a relationship founded on love and trust. A reading from the book of Matthew. When you pray, do not be like the hypocrites who love to stand and pray in the synagogues or on the street corners so that others may see them. Amen, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your inner room, close the door, and pray with your Father in secret. And your Father who sees us in secret will repay you. And in praying, do not babble like the pagans who think that they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them. Your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. The Lord's Prayer. This is how you are to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And do not subject us to the final test, but deliver us from the evil one. If you forgive others their transgressions, your heavenly Father will forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, neither will your Father forgive your transgressions.
Together, we are God's people,
the flock of the Good Shepherd.
To fast is to temper our bodily pleasures and desires with sacrifices. We reduce what we allow ourselves and share the excess denied ourselves with others. A reading from the book of Matthew. When you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites. They neglect their appearance so that they may appear to others to be fasting. Amen, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, so that you may not appear to be fasting except to your Father who is in heaven. And your Father who sees what is hidden will repay you. Treasure in heaven, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and decay destroy, and thieves break and steal. But store up treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor decay destroys, nor thieves break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there also will your heart be.
Together, shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, with the Holy Spirit of sacrifice.
It is our duty to increase alms given in order to provide assistance for those around the globe and in our own neighborhoods. By sharing our time, talents, and treasures, we give thanks to God for the many gifts He has showered upon us that we might take for granted.
The Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I shall want. After prayer, fasting, and almsgiving, what if our human nature becomes weak and we limit our attempts at sacrifice so that we are still comfortable? And our offerings are not truly a sacrifice.
May our self be alive in our faith and remain firm and secure. A reading from the book of Matthew. Dependence on God. Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or what your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds in the sky. They do not sow or weed. They gather nothing into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are not you more important than they? Can any of you be, by worrying, add a single moment to your lifespan? Why are you anxious about clothes? Learn from the way the wildflowers grow. They do not work or spin, but I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was clothed like one of them. If God so clothes the grass of the field, which grows today and is thrown into the oven tomorrow, will he not much more provide for you, O you of little faith? So do not worry and say, what are we to eat? Or what are we to drink? Or what are we to wear? All these things that they can seek. Your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given you besides. Do not worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow will take care of itself. Sufficient is for our day is its own evil.
The Spirit of God is upon me. I will work to bring the good news through the word, action, and prayer.
In closing, let us pray the Confiteor on the potential act of the Mass. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, and in what I have done and in what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and to you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
And thank you, Dad, so feel free to use it back in your parishes however you want. And now the second sheet I gave you is a little activity to stop. So if maybe you can break off into three groups of three and talk about what are families like today. Okay. What are families like today? And then I'll have you guys vote for some each. So however you want to break off. Groups of three. Two or three. There's somebody from this group over here that wants to share.
I was taking notes, so I can just kind of tell you what we were talking about.
Thank you.
So, families today are more scattered, you know, like some overseas. Families are too busy. There was more sharing in the past than now. The families are cold and impersonal because of social media, Facebook, internet. Families are fragmented, and it's a challenge sometimes to reach out to families in need. Families need to talk to each other more. They need to pray together more. Some families don't have a real solid prayer life. And families are ill-equipped because they're under attack. Like a lot of families are broken, mm-hmm. and we need to kind of go back to the nuclear family versus the big extended family. And then the last thing we got to say was that there's confusion of roles of males and females. Mm-hmm. Did I get it?
You got it.
Okay.
All right,
anything different?
Ditto? Minority, there are those who are fighting for that tradition.
Yes.
There are those who have that strength, who want that unity. And there are those who are more careful. There are those that want more. They have that desire for more, that closeness, and they want it for their children. But not only that, they want that for their community. And then, like they said, a need for a God-centered life. And she said, go back to nuclear. And as I'm sitting here, I'm thinking, we need like more generational interaction with the older generation. Now kids are like, whatever. You know, back in my day, you'd be talking, you'd go over to grandma's house and play.
Yeah.
And Grandma would teach you so much, so many things, you know, nowadays, I don't see that. So.
And then, of course, you know, back, we were talking, like, when we grew up, you know, life was different. How, if you back talk to anyone, you know, you'd be in another state. You know, but these days, that's not happening. You know.
And I feel that families just aren't catechized today. Like, speaking for my generation, those who are 40 or 50. Unless you had a family who brought you to church, you're an active participant. But nowadays, I'm thinking if they didn't go, they don't still go. They don't care.
We weren't given the tools. You know, you go to Catholic school, you don't go to Catholic high school, you don't have any Catholic, like your friends are Catholic, and you go to church together, but there's no community like that. No, it's not for teenagers, I think, and that makes us, unless we truly are invested, you know, we're not going to raise another generation, you know, so I see that happening, like, generational, because we don't have the tools, because we're not immersed.
All right, so I'm going to show you a little bit of what I know about engaging families in a catechetical study. And I do have a PowerPoint for you all as well. And I do apologize for a couple things. It's in black and white. We work at parishes, so we don't have that much money to put everything in color, so I really apologize for that. And the second thing is I won't touch all the words in the slide. That might be too wordy. So just a few main points, but I wanted to give it to you to have. Just so you know that ahead of time. So maybe if I can do it at this side.
So did we have another group that we're the week for?
No, only two groups.
Oh, there was only two?
Yeah, they
didn't follow directions.
Yeah, we just didn't get
it. Oh.
That's okay, it works either way. Good job, Dad. Exactly. You'll find out in this slide, in this presentation, too. I mentioned that a lot. But first, we're going to talk about the catechetical documents on the family. The first one, Love is Our Mission, is a document that was given out before the World Meeting of Families, which I had the honor to attend, with 9 other representatives from the diocese. And it was phenomenal. I'll get into that as I go into the document more. The second one is the role of the Christian family in the modern world, which was one of JP2's apostolic exhortations. Another one was the Gospel of the Family by Cardinal Walter Casper. And of course, the Joy of the Gospel, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with. The Mission of the Family. And the newer ones, the Joy of Love, which was put out after the World Meeting of Families. So we'll touch a little bit about those. And I do
add a form that we can see too on the table. And just so, just a note, I did create for family Guggenheim actually a whole additional activities for families based on levels of remission. So you're welcome to see that afterwards. Okay, so the family fully alive. Like I said, there was a document that was prepared by the Archdiocese of Philadelphia and the Pontifical Council for the Family, anticipation of the 8th World Meeting of Families, which took place in Philadelphia, September 22nd, 2015. And that document pretty much explains how all of Catholic teaching is about sex, marriage, and the family flows from our basic beliefs about Jesus. In that book, it's actually divided into 10 themes, 10 chapters. So this is right there for you. So, Created for Joy, the Mission of Love, the Meaning of Human Sexuality, Two Become One, Creating the Future, All Love Bears Fruit, Light in a Dark World, A Home for the Wounded Heart, Mother, Teacher, Family, the Nature and Role of the Church, and Choosing Life. Next one, the Gospel of the Family. Actually, it refers to the family as a field hospital, okay, where it's actually necessary to bind many wounds, dry many tears, and establish reconciliation over and over again. Family life also desires to be cultivated according to the three key phrases of the Holy Father, Pope Francis. May I, thank you, and I'm sorry. Praying together, receiving the sacrament of reconciliation, celebrating the Eucharist, all together are aids for repeatedly strengthening anew the bond of marriage. And understanding that the church is that domestic church. I can't emphasize that more and more. Okay. And again, families are the first and best messengers of the gospel of the family, like we said earlier. Another one, the role of the Christian family in the modern world. I'm going to touch on the second paragraph mainly. Christian revelation recognizes two specific ways of realizing the vocation of the human person in its entirety to love, marriage, and virginity or celibacy. Parents, the educated mission finds a specific source in the sacrament of marriage, for which the task of bringing up children constitutes a real ministry of the church. The next one, I love this one. Family, become what you are. That's what it's all about. St. Pope John Paul II said. The family needs to, there's four main tasks of the family. Forming a community of persons, serving life, participating in the development of society, sharing in the life and the mission of the church. And actually, I have it indicated in the back of this different strategies you can use, but I did bring an example just to show you. Maybe in the opening of the year, the school year, I'd gather my families, and we would actually talk about the whole mission of the family. And they would each create a family shield. So like, and the first one would be the forming a community of persons and examples. We say, I love you to others daily. We forgive one another. We take date nights regular daily as or weekly as a couple. We visit our grandparents. And then serving life, they could be, we open to new children. We watch other families' kids so that parents can be together. We cook meals for new parents. And then participating in the development of society. Examples would maybe be a home is a place of hospitality, sharing with those in need, cooking for somebody who is sick, maybe. And sharing in the life and mission of the church. We pray as a family, we go to reconciliation together. Again, our home is a domestic church. We tell others about the faith. So I do have about maybe 4 or 5 of these that I'm willing to give away. So if you want this to take back with you as an example of what we need. The next one, the Holy Family versus the Christian family. And I think even down to the wee little ones, we can relate that. The Holy Family is like the Christian family. Like, looking to them for an example. Saint Joseph always guards, protects, and enlightens his family. Well, our fathers should be doing that in our families. The Virgin Mary is the mother of the church, and also the mother of the church of the home. So our moms are like the Virgin Mary. So we kind of like relate the two together. And then, of course, Jesus, who is like a child, like the children. Okay? Questions? Yes?
What do you do if you're with a room full of non-traditional families? Maybe there's no father figure in the family. Would you still spend time talking about the Holy Family?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. There are examples. They're the examples for us to follow. Okay? The mission of the family. The Old Testament. It begins with the story of creation. Okay? We are made in the image and likeness of God. The human person is made for family. And then this goes right through the New Testament, talking about relatives. Like around Christmas time, in the Gospels, we read, and so begot such and such. They are real life people who are Jesus' grandparents and great-grandparents and great-great-grandparents. And I also have a family tree that I do with the families as well. Poppy's over here, looking at too. Okay, next slide, you all might recognize somebody in there. Again, St. Pope John Paul II referred to the family as a school of virtue. That's why it's so important to teach, even in our religious education class, virtues. Have a virtue for that Sunday. Something, have a little newsletter or something with a specific virtue on it. And a ways to incorporate that into the daily lives that week. The rite of baptism calls the parents the first teachers of the children in the ways of the faith. Okay, and this slide is actually a family RCIA. There's two different families here that came into the church together, the kids. So, anyways. And for baptism, maybe you have, like, I know in our parish, the priest does the baptismal prep. Maybe the deacon does it. Maybe there's even a couple. But I was thinking, even this morning, I was thinking, maybe you have a couple that has a little baby and had the mentor, the baby being baptized, the family that's being baptized, coming into the church. The family is the place where we learn about social graces. Parents, therefore, have a special obligation to be as virtuous as they can be. And the most important school your kids will ever attend is that kitchen table. How sad it is these days, it's like in the car on the way to hockey practice.
Send you the free bulletin insert for you to, you know, occasionally once a month or whenever Of course, I can't think right now what the name of that is, and I know I sent it to you, but I'll see if I can't find it. But the one that I saw looked really good.
Two of us were going to.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. That's a great question. And exactly, we have to reach those families where they're at. I can't emphasize that enough. This is what I try to do so very much in my marriage. Okay. The joy of the gospel, which I really like that Pope Francis came out with. Growing number of parents do not bring their children for baptism. They don't teach them how to pray. Why is that? We talked about briefly before we began. There's no dialogue in families. Opportunity for dialogue. The influence of communications media. The strong one. Lack of pastoral care among the poor. The failure of institutions to be welcoming. It's a big one, I feel. And the church must be a place of mercy freely given, where everyone can feel welcome, loved, forgiven, and encouraged to live the gospel of life. That's very important. I think that's going to be said for each one of us, too. Sometimes we don't feel welcome. Sometimes we don't. How are they going to feel welcome? Okay, any questions on this part? I don't want to move on until if you have anything you're thinking about, any other comments.
Well, we're running a religious program in the St. Regis Mission. And we also run Mohawk language classes in the community. And so our little First Communion kids, you know, what we're seeing is that, you know, we're teaching them the prayer, we're teaching them everything on this communion, but it's not reinforced in the home. And so, you know, it's like talking to the wall. Like, the kids get it when they're there, but then when they leave, it's not reinforced.
Do you have parent meetings for the
sacraments? Well, what we do is we've been having the parents sit in the classes with the kids. So the parents are learning the lessons, and that's helping.
Yeah.
But it's like teaching Mohawk language. If we're teaching the little, you know, first graders to speak Mohawk, and they go home and their parents don't speak Mohawk, then it's not reinforced. And it's the same way with the First Communion and confirmation. We're getting kids coming in for confirmation that know nothing. You know, they've forgotten everything that they took for First Communion because it's not reinforced.
Kind of going off that, my mom actually teaches a family who can't, or they're learning to come into the churches, being baptized and stuff, but they're a little bit older. But what she's doing is actually giving the kids homework that they have to do with their parents. So the parents are brought in, forced to bring in, to be able to do that homework with the kids. And so that might be an idea that you might have to learn.
Well, we've been doing that too.
Oh,
with the confirmation, we've been sending stuff home with the kids, mm-hmm. and then they have to do it with their parents and come back. So it's a challenge.
It is a challenge.
Yeah.
It really is a challenge. And what we do at the parish for Sacrament of Prep, I have family meetings for the Sacrament of Penance right in September. As soon as the second week after Pass is begun, the first class is actually a whole family gathering. The whole family comes in, and that's when I do activities that, okay, what is the mission of the family? Something they need. Don't go over their heads, they're not there yet. Just reach them where they're at. And then the second week is when we call in all those who are for first penance, all the second graders, and just the parents come in. And we reach them, we try to reach them where they're at. We give them the tools, we hand them the tools. They get the child's book. They have to start the first chapter with them. Have that done before they come to class the next week. And then the same thing for confirmation. This year, actually, we started having the parents sign up to come for a class just when they are available and bring a snack and stay and be there. They're the facilitators. They help us with small group discussion because they don't want to be lectured at. They want to participate in it. They enjoy that. We currently use the Chilton program for confirmation and for the First Communion and First Penance, we use Signs of Grace, Augustine Institute, which is wonderful. It uses the Forgiven series, and there's a whole bonus section on how to teach, or for parents, how to teach reconciliation to the children. Yes.
You know, you're kind of assisting the parents in becoming future catechists as well.
Exactly. Because they are the first catechists.
They are.
They are the first catechists.
They may enter into ministry at some point when their children are grown.
Exactly. So first penance, we usually celebrate it in December, but the past 2 years, we used to have a community penance service, but now we say when the kids are ready, as long as before the day of first communion, when they're ready, they can receive their first penance. And then in January, I have a meeting for first communion with all the parents, and then they start their first communion prep. And then usually in May is first communion, as we all are aware.
What was one year's confirmation?
Chosen. Ascension. Press. And there's many, many international speakers and Chris Devonick and, yeah. I think he's lovely. Okay. Anything else before we go on to different strategies? And these strategies, again, I use them on Sundays and in place of the class. The whole family comes. Once a month, and we do just a family gathering. And some of you probably do this in your own parishes. And I did bring a book, A Family of Faith. This actually is for family catechesis, like give the parents the material and have them take it and do it with them at home. So, but I do have one of them as well. So strategies to help engage families. Okay, the first thing again at the very beginning of the year, I also do a family blessing where each family comes up with a first of all, the bowl of water is blessed by the pastor or the deacon at the beginning of the family gathering. Kind of reminds us of our baptism. The families come up one family at a time, and each person of the family makes the sign of the cross on the other's forehead. Okay. I usually play background music for the coming up. Next one, shadow rosary. Choose one of the mysteries, joyful, glorious, sorrowful, or luminous, and work with the children either in your religious education classes or the youth group to act out the mysteries. Pray the rosary with the whole parish family. And if you have any questions about this one, you can ask Lorraine. She's an expert at this shadow rosary. She does it for us at Family Guggenheim.
We do the shadow rosary at Guggenheim, and just this past weekend, last weekend, we did the shadow station for our family day, and that turned out really well. It's not really hard, but just getting the stuff up. And what I do is I get the picture. I have pictures of the stations, so that's how I try to figure out how to stand them up there. And it's easy. I got poles and a sheet, and, you know, everything set up. So if anybody's interested in doing that, if they're at the parish or anything.
Well, this kind of goes off the last slide, really. But I just wanted to mention one thing that I thought was actually kind of cool with a family that I met out in Missouri. One of the traditions that they did since their kids were really young, before the kids went to bed, the mother and the father would pray over their children. And it was one of those things that that they thought it was very powerful to their family. And they made that a tradition, so even when they were all older, the parents always did that as that part of that tradition, and it brings it right back to, you know, the Holy Family, you know, that connection with that. So I thought that was interesting and great.
So going off the previous slide as well, I don't know if all of the parishes do it, but like on Father's Day and Mother's Day, Father has all the fathers come up and he blesses them all.
Uh-huh.
And then the same on Mother's Day, and then I think even Grandparents' Day, he has, you know, all of them come up to the altar and then he blesses them. Do other parishes do that?
Mm-hmm.
We just stand up.
Yeah,
yeah,
we just
stand up and he blesses them.
Oh, okay.
Another thing, too, I'll get to it later, but speaking of the whole blessing. And I do it in my classroom too. Give the families a bottle of holy water. They don't have it. Where can they find it? They don't know where to find it. You got to give it to them. So, a little bottle of holy water. I usually do that when I get to my house with some kit, which I had for you to see as well. So, all right, next one. Is a family and affair, which I'm quite sure a lot of you do that as well. It's where the families make an advent wreath for the home tables. Prayer cards for the weekly prayers are provided, so families can include these traditional prayers in their home for their life. And then when we're done, advent wreath is blessed by the pastor or the deacon. In our parish, we have a parishioner that donates all the greenery, different types of greenery, to make the wreaths. So, yeah. The next one is coming up. Family Lenten Fair. This is fun. Families work together to create an Easter garden, and I gave you the instructions on where you can find it. Begin the gardens about a month before Easter so that they can watch the grass grow, begin to grow, just like our journey of faith grows. So let's make sure, correct? So you can see that as we get closer to Easter.
I can start that now, it should be good.
Yeah, I have my gathering on March 24th. So it's 2 weeks. And then Easter is not until April 21st.
So we grow a little bit.
Yeah, just a little bit, yeah. And then continue that, you can have them make pretzels. I gotta have the Easter garden there. Stage of the cross, together for families. And I brought my whole binder full of giving the Catechesis ideas. And in there I have Stage of the Cross for families. But you can easily Google online and find it. I make sure you put Catholic Stage of the Cross for families or Stage of the Cross for Catholic families. I believe it's on there,
like
somewhere.
Different things that classes do, and put the link on the diocese website. Where would you go, who would you have to contact? Like say we found something really nice that we thought other...
Share it with Kathy.
Oh, okay. And then I'll send it out to all the catechetical leaders.
Okay.
Kathy or Pam, if those other...
Yeah, but if they send it to me, I'll make sure Pam gets it.
Yeah.
So Marcy, it gets
it. Oh, good. Please do. Please do. Okay, and of course, I just mentioned before, family shields. Instructions in there. Okay, this is something different than the mission of the family. This is another way you can incorporate family shields. And the four squares have them write and draw about their faith, their culture, what they like to do together, who is in their family. So maybe you can display it in a parish hall, parish center. An epiphany, this is where they get their house dressing kit, including holy water, chalk, instructions on how to bless their house for the new year. And then maybe you sit down and have a family discussion. How do we as a family want to witness to the light of the world during the season? How will that light spread? This have those concrete reminders for those family members. Perhaps you would like to have to leave the porch light on, or fly a banner or a flag. Your family may put electric candles in the window. You might spend more time stargazing and clear evenings. If your family enjoys crafts, consider making Chinese lanterns. How will your light touch the hearts of those around you?
Will you be emailing this to us too? This
you have it.
No, I know, but the electronic?
Sure, I can email to Kathy, and she can email to all of you.
Okay.
Okay, we have the Guggenheim, which is very dear to me. Welcomes families of all dimensions to come enjoy a special weekend in the beauty of the Adirondacks. During the summer, we have three sessions, and October, there's one session. It's Columbus Day weekend. It's a great time to celebrate family. Be strengthened by the experience. Gain insight from other families you meet. And just share the love of your family with others. Lorraine, you want to add anything?
Well, I was going to say, so if we, if I send you the form, can you send it out to
Absolutely, I'll do that, yep.
All right, because we've been getting some newer people. It's a great experience. The kids all want to come back. And some of them are older and they go to teen camp. They do come to family camp with their parents and stuff, and it's a little bit different than the teen camp, but they like it that way as well. And the kids talk about it the whole year. They can't wait to come back and, you know, see the kids. And it's just, and I think a lot of people think that it's just, you're just going to go there and you're going to have mass and pray the whole time, which it's not. Sometimes the husbands don't, are not really cool about it. So, you know, some of the parents, the mothers will bring their kids, or they're single parents, or, you know, single dads bring their kids, or single parents. I started going when my daughter was 6, and that first week she wanted to go back. She's 27 now, and we're on staff. But it really is a good experience. You have to use your vacation if you want to come in the summer. You know, it's Thursday to Sunday, but there is a weekend in October that's Friday night to Sunday. So, like, that's my vacation. I take my vacation and do that because I've met so many of my best friends are from there. Because they relate on the same thing religiously, you know, that you can't get with people in. Like, I work with a lot of people and I don't even go to church, or, you know, so. It's things you can talk about with other people that share your same experience religiously. So, and it is very nice. So
you can find registration forms on the diocese website as well. Yeah.
Yeah, I was going to say family life, I think.
Yeah,
definitely.
The new ones aren't out yet.
Oh, they aren't?
No, because I just checked the other day, so I talked to Steve and said they only have the 2018 one on there. So.
Okay, other strategies. Leo Press has meal box cards. They're fun questions and family faith tips to give at mealtime. Keep those conversations cooking. No pun intended. Having materials, coffee, donuts in the parish hall or the gym for parents who have classes are going on. Okay, maybe a little adult faith formation. Think about the pastor. A prayer cue. Okay, where is it? Apologize myself or not already, but take a small box, wrap it up in like gold or red paper, and sit here, and then take like different prayers to it. You want the kids in the family to learn Our Father, Holy Be, Hail Mary, and then say this, roll it, and whatever prayer comes on, that's the prayer you say. Come, Father. So that's another activity. Family activities in the parish, such as movie and game nights, bring back the board games. Having grades 1 through 12 participate in Mass once a month. I know we have our 3rd and 4th graders coming up the 17th. They're going to be readers, they're going to be alpha servers, they're going to be gift presenters. Then I have family-friendly websites for you, and there's many, many more.
Can I go back on the movie?
Sure.
I'm not sure, is there insurance things that you have to do, like if you want to have a movie for them to come in, because I, you know how every place you have now, it's like you got to have insurance and all that kind of stuff. I don't know if that's the same for that or not.
I talked with your DRE.
Yeah, technically you have to buy a license. It's a special license. I do that for the nonprofit I created. But you might be able to get away with it in a parish setting, if you advertise it for the whole parish type thing, then you might have to get a license for it.
I think that's
if it's going to be a mass, you know, if you're going to use like a mass advertisement type thing, then I would be safe to do that. But if you're going to do like a small group or something,
but if the
like
parish
that,
purchases
the
movie.
The parish can purchase,
okay.
But the parish can do it.
Yeah.
It's the company I work through. It's about $125 to $200 per showing per movie.
Oh, okay.
So
you have to pay for it.
Yeah.
Time.
So and each time you have to pay for it.
Because we did have a movie day on Sundays, but it was for people, anybody in the community.
Yeah.
Like it wasn't just for the parish, and they don't do it now. And I think somebody's
yeah, it's because
insurance.
It's because of that, the copyright laws. Yeah.
Okay, family-friendly website.
websites. Leo Press is a good one. They have a lot of things out there. It's a Catholic family. Catholic Family Faith. Well, I have two of them that I don't like. I think one was just a blog designed to enhance the faith development of the domestic church. CatholicIcing.com, I love that one. CatholicMom.com. NetSmarts.org, guidelines for parents to help families learn about internet safety.
Peanut Butter and Grace is a good one.
Yeah, Kitty Bear is.
Oh, all right. Jump in the gun.
Continue. Domestic Church helps to promote a Catholic culture in the home that will aid each family to become what you are. Enter Under My Roof, some of the blog spot. The Religion Teacher is a good one. Of course, the USCCB with the mass readings and other great ideas out there. MassTimes.org, which we actually give to our families if we're going to be away at a hockey tournament, to make sure you go to Mass. We require at least our second grade families and those preparing for our First Communion to bring back a sign bulletin by the parish, by the pastor. CatholicPlayground.com is another good one. Like Kathy said, PBGrace.com. Of course, Pinterest. And I apologize, little square didn't come out very good on yours. The Seven Habits of the Catholic Family. I'll say them briefly. Pray together. Attend Mass. Have an ongoing family charity effort. Get sacred art in your home. Go to confession frequently. Use Catholic media and celebrate. So, and that was a Catholic link that I found on Google. So. All right, now we're going to break into discussion again. So, in our same groups, if you want to mix up, feel free to mix up. The first one, what family-friendly strategies are you using in your parish right now that work? Question two, what do your parishes do for sacrament of preparation of baptism, penance, Eucharist, and confirmation to include families? And the question three, what will you take back with you and implement in your programs right away if you can? So I'll just give you some time right now to discuss that. We'll gather back together to share our answers.